I'm on my way to the registration, and I'm just really anxious. Social anxiety. You guys don't know. In ballet, you have to act a certain way. You have to act quote-unquote white. You have to act right. And even though this is, like, more relaxed, open, trying to be, it's like, last time I went to one of these, even just in regular ballet class, but last time I went to one of these workshops, you know, you just all get all kinds of different people, and to me, honestly, I like to meet new people, but it's like, some people have bad vibes, and it's really hard to take, because they respond to you in so many ways. You're not good enough. They respond to you in a way that's like, you're not good enough in a certain way. Or they respond to you, they respond to you in a weird way that, like, you're too good in a way. It's like managing all that. And it's like, I just want to be pleasant and peaceful with people, but I feel like
in 1,000
not
feet,
everyone
turn right
has that goal when they interact with people. It's like, it just brings me back to all the other situations.
Turn right on Adams Avenue.
Where it was social and I couldn't connect with anybody. Or people didn't want to connect with me. And it's like, cool, is that gonna happen? Am I gonna have no friends? Am I gonna be eating lunch by myself again? And I don't want to be imposing on people if they don't want to eat lunch with me, because I can feel that too. Like, if I sit down with people and I feel like they're like, why is she here with us? Like, how do we act?
Quarter of a mile. Turn left on Newland Street.
I'm scared about how to act, and I just don't want to be a loner, you feel me? Which I feel like I probably will be.
Turn left on Newland Street.
And it's just so embarrassing. Because, like, I'm not the greatest dancer, so can I at least, like, have some friends? I'm just scared that I'm not gonna make any friends, and people are gonna think I'm weird. I feel like that's part of the thing, because it's like more chill vibe, so it's like, have fun making new friends, but it's like, does anybody want to be my friend? This is day one of the Catherine Morgan and Friends ballet retreat for adults. And I am an hour early because I just gave myself extra time. Better early than late. I don't know the temperature, but it's pretty cold. And I left my house thinking, I don't need a sweater. I don't need leg warmers. It's July 3rd, people. It's cold, man! I'm cold! I'm taking a break from social media right now, but I want to document this retreat, so you'll see these vlogs later. I don't know when. Later. Today we're doing a photo shoot. Okay, so let me tell you something. I can't really tell you because my schedule's on my phone, but every day we have technique, we have point, we have, I think, variations, and cardio bar. I don't know if we do other things, but then we also do fun extra educational kind of stuff. Like today we're gonna have a nutritionist To the Point Nutrition. She's going to come and talk to us. She also designed a meal plan for all of us. All of our lunches are going to be prepared for us. It's part of our tuition. I'm excited about that. And also, we're going to have a photo shoot today and tomorrow. People are scheduled different times. I'm in the first half hour, so I'm kind of scared. And that's actually a point of contention. Is that the right word? It's a point, it's a sore subject, you feel me? I feel like a lot of women, but a lot of women in ballet, we have body image issues, okay? Part of why I love Katherine Morgan and Friends is because it's really a body positive group. But even within safe spaces, it's like you can still have issues. So I've been actually struggling with my body image for a while. I mean, I used to have an ED, whatever. I was in recovery. I was doing great for a long time. But just being back in ballet can be really triggering, you know? So I've been struggling with that for a while. So I'm kind of scared. honestly. Social anxiety. I talked about this on my Instagram stories. But of course, by the time you see this, those stories are long gone. I'm really trying to focus on just getting the most out of this retreat. It's a really cool opportunity, and I feel like I felt when I used to take summer intensives when I was in high school. I'm just really excited. I want to show you, we got like a swag bag yesterday. Yesterday was Sunday, and we had like a meet and greet / registration where we picked up our swag bags. We signed up for different fittings. Gaynor Minden is coming, and also Orza, Seth Orza's ballet company, ballet shoe company rather. So I'm gonna do a fitting for both of them, but probably won't buy any of the shoes because my budget is very tight because I'm going to New York in a couple weeks. But anyway, this is the swag bag. Isn't it so cute? It's iridescent, holographic, says KM and Friends. And it's pretty sturdy. I'm using it to hold all my extra stuff for my photo shoot and notebooks and stuff, but they also gave us like a Katherine Morgan and Friends beach blanket, some slides, and this other like wristband thing that everyone's trying to figure out what is this. I don't know what it is. And like a whole bunch of coupons for other things related to ballet. We'll see how it goes.
Not just disordered eating, but also dance-related injuries. And as I mentioned before, because of this vulnerability to picking up these unsustainable and questionable habits around food, it's important that as dancers, defining what it means to be the healthy dancer. The reason for this is because the term healthy in and of itself, though it might seem straightforward, unfortunately, it does come alongside a lot of confusion, even a lot of elitism. And we have to learn how to redefine what it actually means to be healthy. And in doing so, what we're going to be covering today, what I cover with all the dancers that work with me in The Healthy Dancer, are six very key specific phases, from dismantling something called dancer diet culture, what we're going to learn a lot about today, to making peace with food. We'll just briefly touch on body confidence today, but for the most part, because I want this workshop to really help provide you with some insight in how you're fueling your body for the upcoming 5 days, we're going to really be focusing on nutrition, but without exception, implementing performance nutrition principles, and of course, building sustainable habits. So the framework of The Healthy Dancer comes from a compilation of two major bodies of practice in the nutrition world. One means something called intuitive eating, which is a 10-step approach created by two well-known and wonderful dietitians, Evelyn Triplet and Elise Resch. I'm a certified counselor of intuitive eating. The other is the world of sports nutrition and the specific principles that we utilize in the athletic community. The problem with sports dietetics is that it often becomes very restrictive and very excessive for a lot of dancers. And this is where this very delicate balance comes in of, you know, well, how can we utilize this nutrition information but without becoming too excessive about it? So what I really like to focus on, I'm just going to leave off, are nourishing our bodies, satisfying our mindsets, freeing our emotions so that we don't spend too much time, or really any time, ruminating about stressful emotions with our food, and therefore we can actually access our emotions in class and utilize it for the better of our dancing. Of course, enjoying our experience, whether that's on the studio or at meal times, and of course, appreciating our current selves. It's so easy for dancers to always want to love, we're kind of training from day one to always think of how we can be bettering ourselves, right? Which is fine, you know, it drives motivation in the studio. It's really what helps us to learn and to grow. But sometimes, you know, just a little bit about me, I'm a classic former recovering perfectionist. So the idea of constantly improving oneself actually ended up being a bit of a challenge for me because I couldn't necessarily see the good of what I was already doing. I was always so focused on what I can improve upon to the point where it landed me in burnout. And we have to really learn how to find a way of fostering improvement in the studio while also having an appreciation for what we are doing and what we're accomplishing. What makes the healthy dancer? So in keeping up with what I was mentioning earlier about redefining this word healthy, you know, we would ask the industry to say, okay, well, how do you define healthy? I can assure you that many people will immediately resort to talking about, well, your better food choices, it's about diet, maybe it's better exercise patterns. Oftentimes, we don't talk enough about other aspects of health, like physical training routines, our confidence, our mindset, but also determinants of health. Determinants of health are essentially other factors that really do play a critical role on anyone's degree of health. So this could be anyone's access to appropriate medical care, access to nourishing foods, right? Having the ability to hop in a car, head to the grocery store, hop in a car, head to your favorite bakery. All of that is examples of, you know, opportunities that may or may not be available to some. And it all has to come into the conversation when we're talking about health and what is healthy. Access to education, economic stability, even political impact, all of this matters. Really what I want you to walk away from this slide is knowing that your diet and your exercise routines only make up a sliver of what we define as being healthy. In fact, diet and exercise make up 10% of our degree of health. And the reason why I'm stressing this, even as a dietitian, as someone who essentially works all day to help intervene upon anyone's diet, right, or meal patterns, the reason why I'm stressing this is again to help you understand that that cookie that you're eating or that one meal that might not necessarily be deemed quote-unquote healthy or clean is not going to make or break your health. All of these other factors come into play as well. In keeping up with this conversation, we are dismantling dancer diet culture. Now, one of the most common ways that diet culture presents itself in the dance world is through something called clean eating. If I were there in person, I would probably say, can I see a group of hands who've heard of this idea of clean eating? But just for sake of time, we're going to kind of just move through this. The problem with clean eating is that it really perpetuates this all or nothing mindset that ultimately becomes very unsustainable for us and really limits our ability to experience other aspects of life. If we're trying to follow clean eating patterns, and of course we're stressing out about them, we might might become very overwhelmed with food rules, which ultimately make it hard to eat out, might make it hard to eat at restaurants, might make it hard to eat food that you have not prepared yourself. So if you're falling into clean eating patterns, it ultimately becomes very unsustainable. But it doesn't end at clean eating. There's a lot of ways in which dancer diet culture does present itself in the studios, some of which include calorie counting, weighing our food, even wellness trends like detoxes or juice cleanses, macro counting, and very rigid eating schedules. These are just all things that I want you to understand as being, have a bit of a red flag when you see these types of words. Because although they are often presented to us very like ideal terms, like usually around the new year, for example, we might see a lot of these terms utilized to sell products or gym memberships, whatever it might be, but you should recognize your red flag that these lifestyles, quote unquote, are really unsustainable, leading us to what we call a cycle of restrictions. I call it the cycle of unfair expectations. Why are these expectations unfair? First of all, what are the expectations? To abide by strict food rules in order to micromanage our food choices, or let's just say as an example, attaining health. The problem is our bodies biologically and psychologically will challenge restrictive food rules. On a biological level, we are designed to essentially fight back when we are either not eating enough carbohydrates or not eating enough fat in our diet. Hormonal shifts will occur and our body will drive cravings upward, our body will drive our appetite cues upward. So all of these things come into play oftentimes when we're not eating enough or when we're not feeling adequately. Cycle about 15 years ago, but it's the most well-known, it's a very well-known term is what happened here. Originally it was called the female athlete triad. Luckily over the last 15 years, it is well known that all dancers, right, not just dancers who identify as female, all dancers can experience the hormonal imbalances of relative energy deficiency in sport. And what happens here, hormonal shifts occur that increase our risk of injury, decrease your training response. You might experience this if you are either in an intensive or even working year round and you're just not noticing improvement. You feel like you're just staggering, maybe even declining in your abilities. You really want to start to question, am I feeling adequately for this? Impaired judgment, decreased coordination, decreased concentration, which of course all can further drive the risk of injuries in class. Some of the more obvious ones are decreased energy stores and decreased muscle strength. So how do you start to move past? In addition to identifying dancer diet culture, we want to start to heal from dancer diet culture. Now, even if you don't or have never experienced what you might think of as being disordered eating, we can all benefit from learning how to heal from diet culture, because diet culture is all around us. Even just walking through your supermarket, reading a lot of food labels, you are experiencing diet culture. So we want to first always try to identify if you have food rules that are limiting our choices, whether those choices are food choices to bring for your lunch or snacks, or maybe they're food choices when you're eating out with friends. We always want to assess physical fullness and mental satisfaction. One common thing I'll see among a lot of dancers is wanting to choose quote unquote healthier food, let's just say as an example of eating salad, because it promotes a quicker onset of physical fullness. But when we start to talk about this idea of satisfaction, and also this other idea, something called staying power, which essentially is how long a meal or a snack is staying with you, keeping you feeling full and satisfied throughout the day. Now, one thing I want you to understand is that a very practical length of time for a meal or a snack to last in regards to satisfying you is a range from between 2 to 4 hours. It's a pretty big range, but I have to give this kind of range with workshops because everyone's unique schedule, unique bodies, and metabolisms are all different. But what you can walk away with knowing is that most likely you're going to need a snack or a meal every 2 to 4 hours throughout your day. During the intensive, when you're dancing more and your physical exertion is higher, we're looking at a meal or snack every 2 to 3 hours, right? Maybe if you are a little more less physically active during the period of time, going that longer end of the range would make more sense. You might not even feel hungry until 4 hours. But on this note, thinking about hunger cues is extremely important. And one thing I want you to also walk away with knowing is that something like the hunger scale here, which, by the way, I have a blog. It's called dampnutrition.com, and I'll add it to the show notes, or although I think you're all getting resources from me with your lunches, so the website should be on there as well, most likely put it on there. DampNutrition.com, if you were to go there and type in hunger scale, you'll get this exact image. So if you can't write it down quickly or you can't see it today, don't worry about it. The point I want you understanding is that when you're busy and when you're very physically active, sometimes it's hard to fully rely on hunger cues. And this is what we're going to talk a little bit more about, proactive fueling. We're going to get to this in just a bit. But the reason why I want to bring this up is that if you're thinking about that range of getting in a meal or a snack every 2 to 4 hours, and you're thinking to yourself, I'm not hungry within 4 hours. Well, I still want you to try and aim for a snack. It's not that I want you to ignore your body's intuitive cues. It's that we're likely not able to rely on hunger cues right now. And that having a more proactive approach will actually help you to prevent underfueling throughout your day. Another really important point when it comes to this idea of making peace with food and healing from diet culture is something that I've created called the Healthy Dancer Food Flexibility Algorithm. So when I was thinking about, how can I best educate and work with my dancers in a very logistical way about helping them heal from food rules, I'm the kind of person who needs to have a bit of a step-by-step approach. Like, that's what helps me when I'm building habits. So the food flexibility algorithm is literally a step-by-step prompted set of questions that you can utilize in your decision-making around food to help you make decisions at meal times from a place of self-care, rather than from a place of, I should be doing this because it's what diet culture tells me to do. So again, the food flexibility algorithm, if you go to my blog and you type in food flexibility, you'll pull up an entire article that will help you do this. But essentially what we're doing is we're walking through this step-by-step approach. Now, most often what diet culture tells us to do is to jump to the very end of this algorithm, to jump to this idea of thinking only about nutrition. Is there fiber in our food? Is there protein? Is there fat? But there's so much more that we need to consider before we can jump to this. First of all, what is our intent? Is this meal or snack really meant to get me through 4 hours of dancing? If that's the case, then I need energy and I need performance. Or is it a Saturday night? I danced all week. Am I about to go out with friends? What is the intent behind this meal? That sounds a little bit more like it's going to be satisfaction. Of course, we want satisfaction in all of our meals, but building a meal or a snack when you are extremely busy during the week. I'm based in New York, so what comes to mind for me is when you have to eat a snack on the subway. In that instance, I'm not looking for my snack to be the most satisfying experience. Like, it's not going to be satisfying while I'm standing, holding onto a metal bar, and eating the bar at the same time. Not a satisfying experience, but if I have to get something in, if I have a fairly tight schedule, if I'm going from a dance class to seeing a client, like, that's when I have to get my snack. Then, fresh veggies, legumes, fruits with the peel specifically, potatoes, oatmeal, rice, these are all examples. Simple carbs. Think of your fruits that you're not eating a peel. Let's compare an apple where we're eating the peel to the flesh of an apple. This is why simple complex carbs get really confusing, because one food can act as either. If you're eating the peel of your apple, it's going to act more like a complex carb. It's going to be higher in fiber. If you're not eating that peel, or if you're having fruit like melon, it's going to be simpler in carbohydrates, more easily digested.
What was I tripping over? This has been such a fun, chill, informative, supportive day. I was having a freak out, a panic attack. I was future tripping, just thinking about how it has been. You feel me? But this is something I try to remind myself. Just because it's happened a certain way doesn't mean this will be the same way. You feel me? You place yourself when you registered, like which level you'll be. You can place yourself beginning, which is like true beginning, intermediate level, or advanced. And I thought because I just always thought of myself as not up to the level I would like to be. And also because I took a break for 5 years, I thought like intermediate. But when I was in that class, I was like, I should have chose advanced. So I asked one of the organizers if I could switch. And so they're waiting on to see if some advanced dancers want to drop to the intermediate level. And there's like a waiting list, so who knows, but. And then the point class was like, I took the point intensive in February, and it was struggle city, and we only had one point class. And I took my shoes off, I think like 15 minutes left in the class. And this, I was like, I'm chilling. And then the variations class, we have one male in our level. So he learned Bluebird, and we learned from Sleeping Beauty, the Fairy of Purity. It's so cute. It's the one that's like, ding, 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 ding. I'm not doing it right. It's so cute. And I learned the Bluebird one, the male, the real Bluebird, not Princess Florine, except I would like to learn Princess Florine as well. And then the nutrition class was very informative. The food was great. And the photo shoot was great. And I got so many compliments on my hair and other people watching me. And so right now we have a little bit of a break, and we're gonna go to this local dancewear store, and we have the whole store to ourselves, and we have a little discount. So yeah, I'm in the market for a black ballet skirt, and perhaps if they have my point shoes, I might just get my point shoes there, because it's been like a whole, you guys don't even know, it's a whole thing. So I might get some point shoes if they have them. And if I have enough money, I have to double check how much money I have. It's great. And I love all my teachers. I love all of them. It's great. taste test. So we got these little energy bites at lunch. So let's see, this one looks like it has oats and coconut. Has chocolate in there. It's falling apart. It tastes really sweet. I don't know what they're made out of. This one looks like oats as well, but it's darker. More stuck together. Not as sweet. I think it's dates. I see a little bit of chocolate. Cute. Thank you.